So I'm totally open to where you guys want to go and talk about. I will just set the table. I'll give you a little bit on my biography, and then you guys can figure out which of these you want to double click on and where you want to go with the topics and things like that. To help it along, I actually brought some stuff, just in case there are no hands in the air or anything, that we can delve into. Rabbi Glass mentioned the book that I wrote that just came out last week. I brought a couple of excerpts for you that will help illustrate some of the things that Rabbi Glass was talking about. As he mentioned, I grew up a block away from here. There were a couple of times in 12th grade that I ran home for lunch and then came back for class. I think about three Rebbeim before that. But and then after YULA, went to Eretz Yisrael for a year, and then went to college at Penn, and did a combination, started life as an engineer, but then also added on the business side. So I did a combination dual degree program there, ended up spending 5 years there. I can talk about one of the most pivotal discussions that I ever had, which was my last meeting with Rav Shalom Tendler here at YULA, where I wasn't planning to go to Eretz Yisrael. I was, in fact, when I was at YULA, in a rush to get through life. I was going to be graduating YULA at 16. I then wanted to graduate college by 19. And Rav Tendler pulled me aside and said, no, go to Eretz Yisrael. And lo and behold, rather than it being another 3 years between the end of YULA and the end of college, it turned into 6 years. And along the way, I had the realization that it was far more important to do things right than to do them quickly. And that was that shift in my thinking that was sparked by that discussion that I had with Rabbi Tendler, who sent me off to Shalavim, a very formative year for me, set the table, gave me a much more solid foundation that I've been building on since then, first within college, and withstanding several of the things that Rabbi Glass had been referring to that we can talk about a bit. Then after college, went and actually worked in the real world for 5 years, went and started up a practice, was a founder within the firm that I was working for. We can talk about a bunch of the founding issues that I was dealing with there. Went back to Harvard to first get my MBA, and along the way had a couple of people who were mashpi on me that persuaded me to think about academia as a way to both have the intellectual challenge, knitting together all the things that I liked, and also balance the family, the personal, and the professional. And then after doing a PhD program there, I came on board the faculty. And have been studying, this is another thing that if you want to double click on this part, what I focus on, I am an entrepreneurship professor. I focus on the early decisions that founders make that get them in trouble down the road. The pitfalls that they cause for themselves, all the things along the entrepreneurial journey that they are not expecting that then become a real problem that they don't realize that they caused for themselves early on. Things around, should you go and co-found with your best friend? Turns out that's one of the most common decisions that founders make. And yet, major perils that you are causing for yourself, major problems along the way. How do you go and split the ownership of the venture? How do you go and negotiate that with your best friend or the other people that you're dealing with? Getting fired as the parent of your baby, as the CEO of your venture. What leads to that? How do founders deal with it? How can we make that into a smooth transition that they can anticipate and also have more control over? And so those are a bunch of the things that I've been focusing on for the last decade. That's what the book delves into. Let's just take a look briefly in terms of the melding of the that academic and the Torah stuff. Take a look first at the second sheet, the second side of your sheet. Right in the middle of the left page. This is where a whole bunch of my thinking around entrepreneurship has been shaped. By stuff that I was learning here, stuff I was learning in yeshiva, subsequently since then. Here, the metaphor that we use within founding teams, comparing it to marriages, and then seeing what was the first ever marriage that we see in Bereishis. What was the first marriage? Adam and Chava. What does the Chumash refer to them as? This was Ezer Kenegdo, which seems to be an oxymoron, seems to be a conflict. This is one of the things that earlier in the chapter that page is taken from gets into where there's a lot of contradictions within founding teams. The natural inclination to only go and look to people who look like you. Let me go co-found with my best friend who has gone through all the same schools as me, comes from the same neighborhood, likes the same stuff I do, and then you're going to be very redundant The better founding team is where you have differences, but where you also have a basis with which you can communicate and have trust. That is the contradiction that Bracius talks about with Adam and Chava of Azer Kenegdo, a helper against you, where you have at times helping each other, having the foundation and the values and other ways in which you are similar, but then Kenegdo, that you complement each other, you can push each other, where one is weak, the other one can fill in. And there, to me, that captures very much there the ideal founding team. And so that's why within the book, going and reaching out to that as that metaphor to drive that home, where that influenced my thinking about what makes the best of those founding teams. A second example, and this is again when you're talking about within life being able to merge, being a Yid, but also being able to be there, having an impact on the real world. This is here right within the book. All the data that I collected on real life ventures, but then melding it with all of these things that we see, our new insights that we get from Tanakh, from Gemara, and things like that. So the second one of them, you look on the right-hand side on that page. There, as I'm going in and studying boards of directors, that is where I'm seeing within a whole bunch of these that there are boards of directors that are two people, four people, six people. Is that a good idea? No, why not? Odd? Why odd? Okay, so there's clear decision making. They can come to a final decision. This is where the body of decision makers has to come to a final answer together. There, that brought back echoes to me of the Gemara in Sanhedrin that talks about, you got the Mishnah there laying out all the different sizes of Beis Din. You have Beis Dins that are three, you have Beis Dins that are five, you have Beis Dins going up 21, 23, 71, etc. What is that striking pattern that you see there that the Gemara caught onto that boards of directors didn't? All odd numbers, so that they can come to a final decision. What happens if there's gridlock? Well, we add on to the point where we're adding on so that we always maintain an odd number of people on that decision-making board. A very important lesson, excuse me, for boards of directors to learn from the Gemara. They figured it out 2 millennia ago. And yet today, boards of directors all cause gridlock for themselves, all cause major problems in terms of slowing things down, tensions within the board that could be resolved. Startups talk all the time about it doesn't matter what decision we make, just that we make it and everyone buys into it. And yet, this is where things get slowed down, decisions don't get made, and other things that cause major problems that if we can look to the model of Beis Din and see how they make decisions, we can take those best practices and then do that within our startups. And so that's just two examples for you of interweaving the insights that we get from Tanakh, from Gemara, with all the things that we see out there in the world and not seeing it as two separate elements of here's when I'm in the Beis Medrash and here's when I am going to be within the business world and in my startup and doing things like that. Okay, so just two examples there, just graphically from the book of seeing it there on the page. Turn over on the other side. Look at the table of contents. Anyone notice anything unusual about the table of contents? Okay. Anything relevant to what we've been talking about here? Oh, what's in the upper right corner? Beis Samach Dalet, up in the upper right corner. This was a negotiation that I had with the publisher that they actually didn't have that much of a problem with my doing it. I gave them a little bit of background on what it was. But this, to me, is the critical thing. If I am going to talk about why is the book doing well when it's selling and stuff like that, to me, those magical three words being up there in the top right corner and hopefully living our lives by them, of seeing everything that comes by us, whether we see it as good and we say, oh, good, thank you, Hashem, for doing that, or we can't perceive right now why it is happening to us, but it's always Gamzu Latova as things transpire down the road. Critical thing for us to have in the top right corner of life. Critical things to be keeping in mind every time we go through things. To me, this is the comparison. Whenever I am driving and I'm in a rush and I hit a green light, I say, thank you, Hashem. You know, that is one key thing that you enabled me to have fall into place. To me, that's one level of bitachon. But to me, the bigger level of bitachon is what happens when we hit a red light. That, a lot of times, is where our first reaction is going to be the opposite. And what we have to get is to that level of bitachon where we're saying, thank you, Hashem, for the red light also. Because I know that where you are taking me right now, stopping me here, also must be Gamzul Atova. And so to the extent that we can have that perspective on both sides of it, that no matter how things are going, we always have those three letters up in the top right corner of our lives. That's that critical thing as we're going through the ups and downs of life. Okay, so that's just a quick breezing through all of those pieces of it. Now, wherever you guys want to go with the conversation, we can talk about the melding of the two. So to give you one example of where there's sometimes conflict with it, I actually had a major debate with my roommate in college when we were starting to interview for jobs. This was the kippah debate. He insisted that there was no way he was going to get a job if he was wearing his kippah to his interviews. And this is a guy who had also gone to yeshiva in Eretz Yisrael. I was in utter disbelief that he was saying this and having this worry. And to me, the critical thing is that I want potential employers to know what they are going to be getting into. I want to know if there's going to be any kind of problems that I am going to have, that if I'm going to have problems during the interview process, imagine what it's going to be when I am actually working for them. And then December 3 p.m. on a Friday, I am saying to them, you're not going to be able to contact me for the next 26 hours. That there's going to be boundaries on my life where I'm going to be moving back and forth between the business world and the personal world, the world of Yiddishkeit and family and things like that. And so I said to my roommate that what I want to do is broadcast loud and clear as I'm walking into the door, do you really want me for who I am? And I want to know from the beginning if there's going to be any kind of problem, any kind of tension, any kind of way in which there's going to be a hiccup there. I don't want to find out the first Friday afternoon at 3 p.m. that there's going to be a hiccup when I'm working for them. Instead, I want to know it at the way beginning. And so I was walking in the door. I also, this will be a little bit bizarre for some of you guys, but I was graduating from Penn with a three-month-old baby at home already. And there, I wanted them to know. I'm wearing my wedding ring into there. I'm going to be open to them about, I already have a child. I don't want to be traveling too much. I want to be able to balance that also. And so being upfront with them to begin with and having that filtering process going on both sides of it, that's something that A, is true to me, true to representing who I am and my Yiddishkeit as being high priority and at the top of the list of what I'm not willing to sacrifice or compromise at all, but also where I'm going to be able to find the people who are going to be on board and helping me reinforce that, not working against it. And so picking a school where that's going to happen, picking a work environment where that's going to happen, picking a career where that's going to happen. That's another one where you could see it. I know this is ethical dilemmas and things like that. This is the kippah dilemma, if you will, whether you're going to go wear it, broadcast it to everyone. I get questions all the time. So do you wear a kippah at Harvard? Do you wear it on campus? Absolutely. I couldn't imagine going without it. I would feel naked walking into class without it. In class, I had three Lebanese and one Egyptian who are students of mine in class this year. If they're going to have a problem being taught by a Yid, I want them to see the first day of the semester that they shouldn't take my class. It might dampen my enrollment, but it also mean that I'm going to have the people who are coming into it for who I am and what I can bring to the table, and where, yes, they're going to be seeing slides during the semester talking about Ezer Kenegdo. They're going to see things, quotes at the end of class, at the end of the semester, from Pirkei Avos, talking about Ezer Huashir and things like that. And so to the extent there that they have to buy into that journey and take the melding of Yiddishkeit and the professional, that's what I am trying to be loud and clear about to all of these people. Okay, so any thoughts, any questions, any things that you guys want to double-click and burrow into? Or is it still too early? Mazel tov on the win, by the way. Go ahead.
What were some of the major differences that you saw? You said you went to both Penn and Harvard. What were the major differences you saw between the two environments of the two schools?
So I don't know Harvard undergrad, but I can talk in more general terms there. Penn had very much a culture of, it's interesting in this sense, we're talking about melding two disparate things, Yiddishkeit and the business world and things like that. Penn had very much a culture of melding two different things. I walked onto campus as an engineer, but they very much encourage you to find another arena to study in addition so you can combine things. And so that's where I went and explored There was an artificial intelligence program that was psychology plus computer engineering. Went and explored that. Went and explored the business plus engineering. Decided that that was much more what I liked and wanted to do and things like that. Harvard, I think that they want you to be relatively broad, but it's not this encouragement of go deeply into two disparate things and meld them together. And at Penn, that really resonated with me in terms of there's all sorts of muscles I want to build. I don't want to just have a really strong right bicep. I want to have both of them built up. I want to be able to lift things that I wouldn't be able to lift if I just had that one side of me being strong. And so I think there, if you want to go deeply into a single arena and be a little bit broad, that's where Harvard is encouraging that approach to what you're going to be approaching in your undergrad years. Penn, it was very much, let's take these two things that are almost never combined. Let's go and smash them together and see, can magic come out of that? And so that was what I experienced there with the two of them. The interesting thing at Penn, this is when I was starting there in 1987. So that's like millennia ago for you guys. But at that time, we had a problem getting a minion each morning. We would have to go some mornings and call for a 10th. And then by the time I was graduating from there, 1992, having taken the 5 years, because to do the two things there, it takes 5 years to do it, there were two minyanim every morning and never a phone call to go get a 10th. I think Harvard is somewhere in between. There's never been that boom that Harvard had had on the Yiddishkeit side. It's still a much smaller Hillel. It's still not the same intensity of Jewish engagement on campus and things like that. And so that's in that other arena about the difference between the two schools.
Did you ever feel like, as a professor in Harvard, that someone like a different race, different thing, felt bad because you didn't want to learn with you because you're Jewish? Like, did you ever feel like people just walked out of the class when they saw your kippah?
Maybe I'm just not perceptive enough, but no, I have never had that. Well, there's two different sides. There were some required classes for my first 4 years. They were sentenced to have me. Like, they didn't have a choice about it. Now, teaching my elective for the last 4 years, that's where they have very much that choice. That's where that first day, if that person from Lebanon is going to walk in the classroom and see a kippah and be turned off, it's entirely possible that that type of thing happens. There's far more the case that I've actually developed some pretty deep relationships with them, and they come back around for advice even after the semester and things like that. And so I've experienced far more of the positive side of it. Whether the negative side, people just not coming around, that I don't know that there's a good way for me to tell that that is happening at all. But it's far more where hopefully there's a melding of the people seeing the benefits of engaging with each other rather than seeing the kippah and reacting in the opposite direction. Okay, any other hot topics?
Yeah. In your study of entrepreneurs, have you found that many look back and say, oh my God, what was I thinking? They have a lot of those what was I thinking moments. That crosses all founders.
Yeah, no, that's definitely. So last night when I was talking, we had about 80 people who had come to this talk that I was giving about several of these pitfalls. There's no way in an hour and a half that I can cover even a small drop in the bucket, let alone all of it. But halfway through, there was a guy who put up his hand and said, you have panicked me about decisions that I've already made that I can see where this is going to be going now. And the problem is that when you are diving into something for the first time, going and founding a startup, something you've never done before, there are all sorts of things that you don't know that are critical if you're going to be able to succeed, but that you don't have a roadmap for. You can't see where are these things going to be going. You don't even realize a lot of times when you're making those early decisions that are going to come back and bite you. You don't realize when you're making a decision what the full range of options is. You also don't know down that road that even if I go down that right fork, around that bend, that takes me over a cliff. And if all of these things, you could have that roadmap and be able to understand it, maybe you'd pick the left fork instead. Or instead of going over a cliff, it becomes much more of a choppy road. Do I have the driving skills to go and do that? I guess here now with your age, this would be a topical metaphor for it. Do I have the right driving skills to do off-road driving? Do I have a car that is going to be good at doing this off-road driving? Or instead, if I understand that that's where the road is going to go, maybe I should go and take more of those lessons. Maybe I should go and get a better car. And that's the same kind of things about arming yourself to go into it. But to the extent that you go in and you don't understand that road ahead, you also don't understand yourself. A lot of times when you are trading things off, until you are forced with a clear trade-off between two things, you don't grapple with which one is more important to me. If I am going to lose control of what I am doing, but I'm going to become richer for doing it, am I willing to make that trade-off or not? And that is where very much you have to do that reflection, you have to do that thinking, that if you're not doing it ahead of time, you're going to end up going down one of those roads and regretting it. And so, yes, absolutely, especially for those first-time founders. Now, that's when they're learning both about the road ahead and about themselves, and then having a lot of those regrets, and in their second ventures. That's where you can see them making very different decisions, because they're finally getting in touch with what makes them tick, finally getting in touch with what is this road ahead, and how can I make different choices to get me to what I want rather than leading me away from what I want. And so that's why that's the whole goal of my course. That's the whole goal of all the things that I've been doing for the last 10 years, of plotting out that roadmap and finding ways for the founders to get in touch with what are they going to prioritize and choose when they are faced with that trade-off between the two of them.
You talked about the Kippa debate as a sort of microcosm for the conflict that you can have between Judaism and the business world. And then you talked about starting up a new practice in consulting. So that can't have been easy, and I think it would be more intense than just starting your career off in an established practice. So how did those two combine? And was there really any conflict once you had made it clear that you were going to be an Orthodox Jew in your career?
So this is where doing that filtering ahead of time was key, because I'm walking into each of these firms that I might be working for and saying to them, I want Shabbos and Yom Tov off. I want to not travel much because of the family and things like that, that led to several of the firms saying, well, we're not for you. The place that I went to right out of school said, we can deal with that. We want to be able to get the best, but the ones we might have to make sacrifices to get them. And there, you won't have to travel much. My first year there, I traveled 2 weeks out of the 52. And compared to the people who were 50 out of the 52, I was at the extreme because I had had already that discussion with them and been able to find a firm that was willing to work with me on that. And then it actually got even easier from there, because as you are building a practice, as you are bringing in the projects, you're the one who can call the shots about, is this all going to be local projects I'm going to bring in? When I am managing things, I can have people on site instead of having to be me who is on site. And so as you get more control over your business world, over the decisions that are being made there, that's where you have more of that balance. And so I would say that it's even more critical in that first job to be making sure that you're picking the organization that will be able to be a fit with you. And then after that, after you're more established there, you can actually go and have more of that control rather than leaving it in their hands to get that balance there. And so actually, in a lot of ways, one good way to be able to have control over that world is to start off with a blank slate of you founding, of you going and writing the rules for yourself, of you being able to figure out what is the culture I want to have there, how is it going to balance the outside life with the inside life. And so that's one of the powerful things that founding enables you to do, of being able to, you probably are going to work more hours as a founder, but you're choosing where are my meetings going to be held, when are they going to be held, all those other things, those are more under your control. And so that's where you have a lot more of that ability to dictate the terms where you're going to be able to have that balance compared to if you're going and working for a large company that's going to be making the decisions without you.
But do you think is it a lot harder than before to get into colleges that you were applying to Penn or Harvard? Was it a lot more challenging than it is now, or is it a lot easier?
I'm not sure. I can give you the lens through my current day engagement with colleges, and that's that my oldest is now a sophomore in college, and she is far smarter than I am, and she got into the one school that I didn't get into, and so I'm not sure, that's kind of mixed signals about it. She's actually at MIT right now, she's a sophomore there, and there also we could get into a bunch of the things of her balancing the Yiddishkeit with being in college. She had done her, now there's actually a sexy term for it. Back when we used to go to yeshiva, we had to go and explain, take paragraphs to explain to people what we were doing, why we were taking a year off. Now there's a sexy term, gap year. As soon as you say gap year, suddenly everyone, okay, that's something that everyone does. That's a good thing to do. For her gap year, she went to Michlala, And so they are the deep learning for that year. And then now she has chavrusas several nights of the week with her old michala chavrusas, where over the phone or Skyping, she's able to learn with them while she's also doing all her things for MIT and being able to balance it. And so hopefully the next generation will also be able to balance the two of them. But that's my one data point, that someone much smarter than I am got into the school that I couldn't get into. That says that it might be about the same or maybe a little tougher for people to get into those same colleges.
So do you, it's a major difference. You see, you can start companies that are developed in Israel and America, and if you have to choose a startup company that you typically like developing right now.
Okay, interesting. This is like for finance people, which stock should I buy as soon as I finish the session with you? We actually had in January a faculty immersion to Israel. This is where about 12 or 13 faculty from across Harvard came together to Israel and got a chance to meet with a whole spectrum of people from the political realm to the legal realm to the business realm to the military realm. And all within 4 days or so, getting to see a full view of that picture of the country. Everything from we had dinner with Shimon Peres to a session with the Israeli Arab member of the Supreme Court to the Navy SEALs. That was actually our first session of the first morning. And then a bunch of startups also. And that gave me a pretty good feel for what you can within 4 days, understand the difference in the lay of the land and things like that. There was very much a distinctive feel for an Israeli talent to take crisis and turn it into opportunity. So for instance, the Navy SEALs that first morning, where Israel, with all of the things that would usually have any small country on its heels and very defensive and things like that, talking about how that translates into the excellence that they are bringing to the jobs that they do. We had a session in the entrepreneurship realm with a panel of entrepreneurs in the water industry, the last thing that I would have thought of as the next high-growth industry. But where Israel, one of its major Achilles heels is no real water resources or anything like that. What that has led to is Israeli entrepreneurs seeing this as, we have to solve this problem. This will be a crisis if we don't. And now that we've solved it for ourselves, how can we go and build a world-beating industry within this arena? And this is where the entrepreneurs who were in front of us had just gotten back from Davos, World Entrepreneurship Forum, World Economic Forum, all sorts of places where they are the ones who are tabbed to be speaking about the water crisis, be up there on the stage, talking to all of these 150 countries from around the world. And they are that inherent ability to go and see where are we going to have a major problem. Let's turn that strength, turn that weakness into a strength instead. That's something that definitely has more of an edge to it in Israel in the startup scene than it does really here. Here, people going and, oh, Web 2.0 is going to be the big thing that we should go into. Social networking and other things along those lines. Israelis were some world beaters in the online world, but it was in mission-critical things like security, mission-critical things like essentially life-important things rather than nice-to-haves, like a lot of times we focus on within entrepreneurship here. And so that's where I think there's a very distinctive element of what the Israelis are bringing to Startup Nation that enables them to do a whole bunch of things that here we wouldn't have as high on our list. The most intriguing one, so if you're talking about picking the startups, those water startups I find fascinating. Like this is one of those leaders, the main guy who's there, the poster child for Israeli water startup stuff, is a serial entrepreneur who had very successful startups in tech and then 2 years ago moved into water. He said, within 2 years, I'm a world expert in this. That's like, that shows you how raw and new that industry is, that he could go and translate his experience in a very different industry into going out and building a world-beating startup within there. And so if I'm going to look there, that's one of the ones that has hit my radar in an unexpected way from having that week there. Just by the way, one tidbit on a very interesting session. I mentioned the Israeli Arab member of the Israeli Supreme Court. There, I asked him at that session whether he has seen any systematic ways that he, Lahavdil in some ways, paskins on the laws that are coming up to him compared to the non-Arab members of the of the Supreme Court. And he said, right after we're done, come back to me with my office and I'll show you something. And what he brought me back to, he showed me on his bookshelf that he has, all in a row, three books. The first one there is the Tanakh. The second one there is the Christian Bible. And the third one there is the Quran. And he said, depending on the case, depending on the insights I have to get, I will go and look in the Tanakh and see what types of things I should be using in my opinions, what should be informing there. And that's where he is trying to, as this official member of the legal-making body within Israel, draw on it also. And so there's all sorts of ways, and it was just a fascinating microcosm there. I took a picture of that bookshelf with the three things there in a row of what he is using and his seeing that there are insights in the Tanakh that he is borrowing when it comes to the legal opinions. I want to someday have the time to pull up some of his and see where he is going and citing the Rambam for something halachically or going and using it where there you have his name at the top of it, but that's where he is using that as his inspiration and his insights for what he's bringing into that opinion there. Okay.
Go ahead. Why do you feel that Israel's economy is so far superior to the American economy, even though they have no natural resources, constant state of war, and what, 10 years?
So that's where part of the question about take a bunch of those things that you put on the minuses list, turning that into a strength, that's a big piece of it. Another one, so one of those minuses, one of the things that's been a big powerful part of it, is taking this influx that you can imagine here. This is a country of, back when it was happening, about 5 to 6 million people. And then you have 1 million Russian immigrants coming into it. This would be the equivalent of 50 million people coming into the United States. This is where a country would be on its heels trying to absorb all of these people and being able to pay for them to be on welfare, bring them up to speed, and yet Israel turned that into a major plus. Some of the major movers and shakers within the startup arena are those immigrants who came on board bringing major skills with themselves. The Israeli Philharmonic is world-beating because of a whole bunch of the musicians who came on board because of that influx. And no country, if you went to the U.S. and said to them right now, would you take on 50 million refugees from another country? Would the U.S. even take in the 1 million that Israel did, let alone the 50 million that its size would be, that same percentage? No. But the philosophy underlying Israel is Kulanu Achim, we are all going to be bringing everyone on board. If you're a Yid, you actually are going to be a citizen of our country. And to the extent there that it's a very different orientation that then turns into, 20 years later, a major help for the economy, a major boom in terms of new talent and things like that. That's another element that would be very hard for almost any other country with a different philosophy to be able to stomach and take that kind of a hit like you have to do early on. And so some of it is cultural, some is that orientation of how they view crisis and how you, what you can do with it. Some of it is the perspective that Yiddishkeit brings in terms of if a Yid needs help, we are here for that. And between the two of those, that's a key piece of what is almost not in any other country, and you bring those two together, and then you can have that magic. Okay? Anything else? Go ahead.
What are the magic words that Rabbi Shalom told you to change your
life? You're going to Eretz Yisrael.
Someone who's so focused on not going and had such a view on life.
Yeah, no, this is where he was telling me that what you want to have is a solid foundation, that YULA has gotten you 90% of the way there for being able to live in the outside world, and that Eretz Yisrael will give you the last 10% of it. Eretz Yisrael will arm you for being able to excel while being able to keep that rock-solid foundation of Yiddishkeit. And talking about it from that perspective, that was where I saw I could go the 90% quick route, or I could go the 100%, take a little bit longer, and be a lot more solid in terms of going in there. And it was that balance that I was starting to see, okay, I had my priorities wrong. That rush was not going to get me to everything that I wanted in life, and this is a way to be able to have the two powerful pieces coming together and be a lot more solid together. Okay? Anything else? Hate to have you guys defer davening for too long. I felt bad when I heard that that was going to be what the schedule was going to be. I'd been looking forward to davening with you guys. Instead, I had to go to a 6:15. But
we thank you.
No, it's my pleasure. Thank you, guys.